G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring.
As something of a side quest to the Antikythera project, in this series I make a modern version of the second oldest geared mechanism on the historical record, an instrument known as the Byzantine Sundial Calendar. An all-in-one portable sundial and calendrical calculator dated to roughly 500 AD. The geared aspect of the device computes the current age and phase of the moon, the position of the sun and moon in the zodiac, as well as the current day of the year. The sundial part of the instrument is based on the now abandoned concept of unequal or temporal hours, where the daylight time before noon was divided into 6 hours, as was the time after, with the length of that hour changing throughout the year. Which is interesting enough on its own, as an indication of how the concept of time was managed in antiquity. Its construction makes it entirely portable. In fact, there are several examples of portable sundials surviving to the present day. There's not so many as to suggest that it was necessarily a common item, but there are enough to indicate that maybe it was some sort of luxury consumer good. It's significant that there's only one example on the record that has evidence of gearing, and it's why it stands out. At the present time, after the Antikythera mechanism, this is the next geared device on the historical record. The original artifact was purchased by the Science Museum in London in the early 1980s. And if you ignore the modern aspects of this version of the instrument, essentially the bits that they purchased were these. Most of the device was missing. It took the then curator of mechanical engineering, Michael Wright, to understand what it was that they'd purchased. And in fact, he built a reconstruction that's now on display in the museum that replicates both its function and aesthetics. But it's important to note, there's no eclipse prediction gearing in the original device. Only calendrical information was displayed. In the course of his research, Wright briefly discussed the possibility that with a little more fabrication work, this device could have been turned into a compact eclipse prediction machine. So that's what I've done with this project. Using his suggested tooth counts, I've extended the design to include a lunar node display. And I've gone just a touch further still, putting that node display onto both dials to make it easier to interpret. With the position of the sun and moon in the ecliptic and the node information, it gives the user everything required to predict the possibility of both solar and lunar eclipses, all of which I'll cover in detail at the end of this series. Now you'll have noticed that the Antikythera project has gone well beyond just simply reconstructing the machine. It's now a fully fledged research effort as much as a build project, requiring a strict attitude towards the engineering processes and the construction details. The engineering of the original sundial calendar artifact is quite similar in a lot of respects to the Antikythera mechanism, so much so that for me it'd be redundant to take the same hardline approach with its construction. So, for the design aesthetics, I've chosen to time shift the device a bit closer to the modern age, giving it some of the flavour of the 18th century. I've used cycloidal teeth rather than the original triangular teeth, and a more modern horological layout for the supporting structure. English replaces ancient Greek on the displays, and modern city names have been used on the latitude table. I've also added a small ratchet disengage cam to permit rapid scrolling forwards and backwards in time when predicting eclipses. Beyond that though, the basic concepts and the engineering sensibilities are pure Byzantine sundial calendar. Little or no clearance between the wheels. Truly archaic pivoting. And the ancient concept of pinning assemblies to hold them in place. It's an outstanding teaching tool for understanding key astronomical concepts, like the motion of the sun and moon in the ecliptic, the way latitude affects the way that we see the sun, and most of all, what causes eclipses. Now, one of the biggest expenses of any new project can often be the required cutters, and that's especially true for clock, watch, and instrument projects like this one, where usually several cutters are required for a single project. The shop-made gear cutting system that I covered some time ago in part 10 of the Tools Glorious Tool series can be used to help solve this problem. So be sure to check out the full set of 5 videos for all of the detail on making your own cutters. The system is a collation of highly effective gear cutting techniques that can give excellent results using straightforward shop-made tooling. There are multiple options to be selected as required, according to the circumstances of the job, and I've tied it all together with a calculator to make the system as easy as possible to use. most importantly. These shop-made cutters can be made using the typical home engineering equipment available on the market today, with minimal materials, and they require no special ability with the machines. Now, to be clear, the commercial cutters are superb, and their cost is understandable given the number of operations and the expertise required to make them. But there's no avoiding the fact that for many, the cutter costs can be a barrier to getting into horology in the first place. Also, being able to make your own cutters is a core skill of the craft. For those occasions when a commercial cutter doesn't exist, or when you're prototyping new ideas and so on. So there's no better way to get a good grounding in all of the key principles of cutter making than a fun project like this one. Now, of the options that I present in the gear cutter series, the easiest to make is the turned fly cutter. They cut well, are cheap to make, and once you get the hang of it, can be made in a matter of minutes. As you'd expect, they do have some limitations. For example, they're unsuitable for cutting steel pinions. For that, the other methods presented in the gear cutter series are the better choice. Now, a steel pinion is less likely to become injured if mistreated, but otherwise brings no particular advantage to this project. The gear train will sit idle for most of its life, experiencing only a tiny fraction of the activity of something like a clock or a watch. So brass pinions are quite acceptable. And in fact, the original artifact had an all-bronze gear train. Before we get started, let's cover some of the detail about the geometry of the modern horological cutters, generally referred to as cycloidal gear cutters. The first thing to point out is that they are not in fact truly cycloidal. They use circular curves at the addendum to approximate a cycloid. And for us, this is a huge bonus, because it makes their form much simpler to replicate. Again, be sure to check out the gear cutter series for all of the detail on how to make a wide variety of cutter types, and to follow along with what I'm about to do here. I'm going to start by making a 0.85 module wheel cutter. The first step is to get the radius of the form tool from the calculator. You might recall when I made a stop work wheel some years ago that I used a button tool to generate the radius required for the cutter. It's a reliable way to produce an accurately shaped radius for the cutter profile. An alternative for the larger module cutters is to grind the radius directly into a high-speed steel blank, using a simple shop-made gauge to confirm the radius. It's not as accurate as a turned button, but can work well for cutters above roughly module 0.5. Next, the top slide is set to the correct angle. In this case, for a wheel cutter, that's 2 degrees. Now, to end up with the required geometry for the cutter, the final cut on the lathe must begin with a lathe cutter tangent to these two points. The calculator gives the position in the x-axis, with this diameter value. We can simply turn the stock down until we measure this diameter, and we'll know we're there. The z-axis position is given by facing off the work, and then locking off the carriage, with the subsequent infeed coming from the top slide. Now, of course, that's all easy to say, but it does take a bit of concentration to get it all correct. So here's the approach that I take. I take up the backlash on the top slide and zero the handwheel collar, and then I do a practice run first, using some free-cutting brass. Turning the stock to the minimum diameter D puts the cutter tip in the correct position in the x-axis. The cross-slide handwheel is then zeroed to record this position. The lathe tool is advanced with the carriage to turn off that spigot, and the carriage is firmly locked to the ways, with the cutting tool just inside the end of the work. Then a simple facing cut positions the form tool in the z-axis. The top slide infeed figure L is retrieved from the calculator. And then I feed in the cross slide towards the zero position that was set on it a moment ago, making the cut by feeding in with the top slide, using that infeed figure L. This is probably the easiest part of the process in which to make an error, since I'm going past the cross-slide zero indicator more than once on my way towards the final diameter D. but with a bit of practice, it's easy enough to get the form tool into the correct position, as defined by the calculator. The final cut from this position is the most important, because it gives the properly dimensioned profile of the wheel cutter. With the practice and setup complete, now the actual cutter profile can be made. In this case, I'm forming it in a length of high carbon steel. Once the turning is complete, the cutting face can be formed by milling away half of the stock, much like the concept for a D-bit cutter, leaving on just a slight excess for removing tool marks and final sharpening. Now, I've used a mill for convenience, but this could easily be milled on the lathe cross slide or by simply using files, depending on what you have available. The tip relief is probably easiest formed by hand with an India stone. And the cutting face benefits from a quick tidy up to remove the tool marks before heat treatment. A light touch on the grinder or belt sander relieves the back edge, completing all of the required cutter features. And as a final step, it's a good idea to stamp in some marks so that it can be easily identified in future. The cutter is then hardened in the usual way by quenching in oil, and then very carefully tempered, with the tip taken to a pale straw colour, by slowly running the oxide colours up from the blunt end of the cutter. This step is critical. If the cutter remains brittle from the quench, it'll simply snap off on the first attempt to cut. Once the heat treatment is complete, the cutter can be polished and have its cutting edges sharpened. Which brings me to the first of a few limitations. First of all, it's not a constant profile cutter, so the profile will change as it's sharpened. But this usually isn't a problem, because the amount of metal taken off with each sharpen is quite small, and at the half diameter doesn't immediately have a large effect on the profile. I've found that I get many sharpens out of a given cutter before this becomes an issue. Another minor shortcoming of the cutter design is that the cutting relief generated from a turned profile is not strictly correct, and so throws up a small burr. The other methods that I present in the gear cutter series have true form relief, but of course the trade-off is that they require a little more time to make. Dealing with the burrs is straightforward with material like brass. A bit of abrasive paper knocks them off easily. A further limitation is, as I mentioned previously, that this sort of turned fly cutter is not suitable for cutting harder materials like steel. It's strictly a light-duty cutter for soft materials like brass. I tend to feed them in very gently compared to a multi-tooth cutter, and use multiple passes for pinions to reduce the chip load. These cutters don't like to be pushed too hard, so keep that in mind when using them. But even so, if the geometry has been correctly formed, and the limitations are properly managed, the end result is a tooth profile that compares well to that made by a commercial cutter. And its performance can be verified using a depthing tool to be quite suitable for many projects. In addition to the wheel cutter just made, three pinion cutters are also required to complete the gear train. The process for making turned pinion cutters is essentially the same as what I've just shown, with the main difference being that the flank angle is steeper. Again, the calculator provides all of the required information to generate cutters in a form-relieved multi-tooth or fly cutter form. Now, as is often the case with this sort of project, completion of the gear train helps to set the direction for much of what follows. So in the next video, I'll put all of these cutters to work, cutting the many teeth of the mechanism. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later.